In between each run and each sample, we are rinsing the sponge carefully with a couple of microliters of acetone. We pull it up, and because it's such a small amount, it doesn't even really become a droplet. We're using the Kim wipe to help wick the acetone out of the needle. So you can see just a tiny little wet spot appears. Along with rinsing the syringe with acetone between samples, we are actually rinsing the syringe itself with the sample to make sure that there's not any acetone left in the syringe either, so we know that all we are injecting is pure sample. Okay. We have a sample in the syringe and it is inserted into the GC. So now we're going to insert the sample and hit collect, so that we can collect our data with the GC. So here is our information that we generated in the gas chromatograph for our N-propanol sample. I've done two things with LagerPro to get us some more information. One, I've run the statistics. I just went up to analyze and selected the statistics option for run number one. And that gave me the maximum point here, which is at 2.12. That's the peak of that curve. And another thing I can do with a graph that looks like this is I can look at the area underneath the curve, between the curve and the x-axis. That is called the integral. And you'll learn how to do that by hand in calculus, but LagerPro can do that for us. So I highlighted this area and found that the integral is right here. It's 1251 millivolts per minute times minutes. Is the area underneath the curve. Thank you. I've done a similar analysis for the N-butanol peak. Now, even though we did use the same number of microliters, the exact same amount of N-butanol as we did in the first run with N-propanol, you can see that the N-butanol makes a much broader, larger peak, even with the same volume of sample. And having done the statistics on this, I can find that the maximum point of this peak is about 4.445 minutes. And you can see the area under the curve is significantly larger. It's 3,143. So this is a much broader, thicker curve. And it does appear that it has a wider amount of time that those molecules are coming and impacting the detector for the butanol, where the propanol molecules all impacted the detector in a shorter amount of time, but also in a shorter spread of time. We have a narrower, sharper peak for the N-propanol than we do for the green N-butanol peak. Now, this is a mixture of N-propanol and N-butanol that we're going to do for the last experiment.
One thing you might see immediately as you're looking at the analysis of the mixture peak is that both of the peaks are shorter and smaller than the pure sample. And that actually makes some reasonable sense because we used the same volume of the mixture as we did for our two pure substances. But in the mixture, only part of the molecules should be N-propanol and part of the molecules would be N-butanol. We do see a pretty similar pattern coming out. We can say with reasonable certainty that we do have the same substances in our mixture as we had as our pure trial substances, because the retention times for both peaks are extremely similar. The first peak comes out right about the exact same middle of the peak as the original pure and propanol. The second peak comes out right in the same area as the pure N-butanol. And you see the same pattern happens again with the height and broadness of the peaks. The integral, the area under the curve for the N-propanol is only 180.5, where the integral for the N-butanol is almost 1500, which is surprising since these were pretty close to an equal mixture of the two alcohols. We also see that we do have something of a problem. Ideally, we would love to find a condition where we could completely separate the two alcohols. You can see, even when we had a pure sample, there is an area here where those two peaks significantly overlap. And that shows up the same way when we look at our peaks in the mixture. So perhaps it would be better to try using alcohols with greater difference in molar mass at some point to see if we could completely separate them, or perhaps changing the rate of temperature change or the rate of flow to see if we could get completely down to the baseline before the next peak begins, which would be the ideal situation.
Just to refresh your memory, these are the two compounds that we used in both the boiling point and the GC lab. N-propanol, the 3-carbon, no branching alcohol, that OH there is an alcohol, is the first compound that we put in and the first component of our mixture. And N-butanol, a straight 4-carbon chain with the OH alcohol group on the end, was the second pure substance we put through and the second component of our mixture. And so what we want you to think about is, why did these two substances elute or travel through the column with different speeds? We can tell which one took longer because the slower something moves, the longer it will take to move through the gas chromatograph column. So just thinking a little bit about gas chromatograph anatomy, essentially this is what we have. We injected into the column, and on our equipment, room air is our carrier gas that comes in through this side here. And the vapor and the air move through the column at different speeds until they hit the detector. And the detector turns that into signals that Logger Pro could read and record as peaks. So what you want to be thinking about is, why did these very similar compounds have different retention times? Why did it take longer for N-butanol to move through the same column, same distance, same material inside the column, than it did N-propanol? And again, we want you to be thinking about sizes of molecules, forces between molecules, what's going on in the intermolecular force world and the size and shape world that are so important to an intermolecular force.